The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... I'm E.G. Marshall. I have a special treat for you. An unforgettable voyage to the islands of Kalea. Where are they? No, don't look for them on any ordinary map. They exist only in the gyrus hippocampi. And that is located... Well, that's what this story is all about.
Werner, is he alive?
The body... That is dross. We will burn it as we do the animals in the crematorium. The brain. Ah, that is something else. And it is doing well. Now the fight is first to keep it alive.
And second?
Each thing in its own time. Isn't it enough that, for the moment, we have created a miracle?
Mystery drama, The Brain Without Mercy, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Ian Martin and stars Norman Rose. It is sponsored in part by Buick Motor Division and Anheuser-Busch Incorporated, Brewers of Budweiser. I'll be back shortly with Act One. Across the southwestern portion of Texas, near the border with Mexico, a smallish two-engine Canadian de Havilland is flying about 2,000 feet and slowly descending. It is the last leg in a long and perilous journey for its two pilots and the three passengers who have been held as hostage. A dark-complexioned man with a Thomas machine gun at the ready and strapped into a parachute keeps a close watch on his terrified fellow passengers. In a large suitcase beside him is $2 million in small, unmarked bills. This is the end of a three-day headline story which has kept most of the country on the edge of their seats.
Okay. Bring her down some more and cut back on the throttle. Hey, you, compadres, move up towards the cockpit. Okay. Hold your hats. I'm going to open the door. This is where your friendly hijacker bids you goodbye. Don't make any crazy moves. Just leave that up to me. Hasta la vista!
1, 2, 3. That's only half as good. 7, 8, 9. Okay. First parachute. 11, 12. Beautiful. 15, 16. 17, a little more to the right, so I hit my spot. 20, and here goes number two. The devil, ring broke right off. Where is that emergency? Carrying too much weight. I ought to jettison something, but not the money, not the dough. Damn, it can't have been all for nothing.
Gently, Willie, gently. We have a precious cargo.
As I may, Doctor, them bumps is on the road.
I realize. Perhaps we should have the headlights.
It ain't that dark. But you're the boss. Whatever you ask. How's that?
Strange time of day, twilight. Can't even see the lights go on. I'm glad you're driving instead. Willie, what is that on the road?
Appears like some fella passed himself out on the edge of the road. He's some foreigner, maybe. Had too much snake juice.
Don't stop.
Might be he needs help. You're a doc.
Oh, very well. Let's have a look.
Hit. Tree. Crossback. Need help.
Who are you? What do you mean you hit a tree?
The money. I had to hold on to so much money. Whole trouble. $2 million. Make a man crazy.
Doctor, he cash in his chips?
No, he's still alive.
You got the place. You and Mrs. Doctor could maybe keep him alive like the animals.
What?
The way you make it so nobody dies. I mean, dogs, sheep, and all like that.
Willie, get the big blanket out of the pickup. You and I will have to roll it onto this man and take him back to the clinic. You must take it very slowly now, Willie. If that man is to stay alive, we must proceed as smoothly as possible.
Sure, Doctor.
He has suffered injuries I cannot understand. Massive internal dislocation and severe compression of the spine.
Doctor, sir, it's going to rain something awful. We might not make the ford.
Not that I do not believe your instincts, Willie, but let's just check on the radio, huh? And remember the word, Willie.
Slowly
and
a low pressure area that forecasts storms and violent rains down through the south and on into Texas, as far south as Mexico. Now, a further update on the man who has been dubbed the Texas Stranger. For 3 days, he has played out his wild drama, starting with a skyjack of a Universal plane bound for New Orleans. Since then, the man has held out for a $2 million payment as he skyhopped around the southern portion of the U.S., a payment which was finally made and delivered as he transferred to a small plane over Texas, still holding 3 major bank officials as hostage. Now, word has just been received that somewhere over the south of Texas, this daring bandit, tentatively identified as Miguel Riveras, parachuted out of a plane carrying with him $2 million in unmarked bills. It is expected that the bandit hopes to escape to Mexico. But in the meanwhile, every agency, government...
Turn it off, will you?
Yes, Doctor. But why'd you want to do that? I wanted to hear more about them rains and the weather.
Forget the weather. Drive as fast as you can, Willie. We must get home. I will need you, Ilsa. We will have to operate right away.
On our new guest, Werner?
The man we picked up, yes.
Not for the experiments.
Oh, no. This is to save his life. He's going into renal failure. Both kidneys are destroyed.
We have no transplants. What shall we operate for?
The greatest opportunity of my life. The body of the man cannot sustain life much longer, but his brain. Ah, that is fully viable. Now, come. I need your help. We have much preparation to make.
Have you reported about this man to the authorities?
No.
But it is the man.
Oh, yes. He has an identification bracelet from a paratroop division.
But you will not report him?
And lose this incredible chance to get the money we need? $2 million to complete my experiments?
But where is the money?
Only he knows.
And he's unconscious.
So I must unlock the secret from his unconscious.
How? If he's in coma and on the point of death.
With luck, I may bring him to consciousness long enough to find out what I need to know. If not,
Werner, what else?
Well, the man is moribund. No way we can keep him alive. But if we arrest the degenerative process, only the kidneys are destroyed, every other vital organ in his body could be preserved by the techniques under which we have been working. Now, most important, and this is the perfect opportunity, the brain.
The brain?
We have maintained the brain of a rat, a rabbit, and more successfully cats and dogs. Why not a man's?
But the man is still alive.
The man is due to die from other causes. And besides that, he is a criminal.
We are not the judge of that.
So we are not the judge. No, Ilse, we are only the fortunate recipients of a golden chance.
But, Werner, how can you risk it? There are enough questions about your clinic already.
There have been no questions about this. This man planned to disappear. I am only making sure that he will. Now, get dressed so we can scrub up. Ilse, You and I are about to perform the most important operation in our lives. So, the perfusion machine will serve to replace his kidneys long enough for our purpose.
The man could be kept alive, perhaps indefinitely, until a kidney donor...
Ah, Liebchen, it is not worth the gamble. Not when we have a better game to play.
Oh, you know what you contemplate is murder.
Technicality, not even valid. For Miguel... that is his name. We must think of him as that. Miguel will still be alive outside his body.
Alive?
Yes. More and more, Ilse, the definition of death is being accepted as the moment when the brain ceases to function. Miguel's brain is not going to cease to function. No, is it, Miguel? You and I, we are going to make history, no?
Werner, what are you going to do?
Well, first of all, we are going to dispose of the last remnant of man's best friend. We are going to take away the life supply of blood from the dog's brain so that we may have it available for Miguel.
Werner, I'm afraid. Do you know what you're doing?
Absolutely. I cannot save Miguel's life under the ordinary definition, but I believe I can save his brain, and I need all of your help.
Have I ever denied it to you?
No, Ilse, no, but do not fail me now. All right. Are we ready?
Yes.
Scalpel. So, doctors. Good. Drill. Now, how is the blood pressure?
Steady. 160 over 80.
Better than I had any right to hope. Now, I need your hands to help put the pressure on audio so we can hear. That's it. We must move as fast as possible. Wipe.
There, Liebling.
Yes. I must expose the whole brain so we can move freely.
His heart stopped.
It doesn't matter. I can switch to the heart pump now. Turn it on. Now, give me the spinal cord. Yeah, good. Now, steady, easy. We place it in the bath with the brain itself. Miguel, alive, swimming again in the primeval slime from which man came. You can cut off all supportive measures except the blood reservoir and the oxygen.
Is he alive?
The body? That is dross. We will burn it as we do the animal's remains in the crematorium. The brain? That is something else. And doing very well. Now, the fight is first to keep it alive.
And second?
Each thing in its own time. Isn't it enough that for the moment we have created a miracle?
You got the food ready for the doc and Mrs. Doc woman?
Yeah, really. But how long have I got to make up trays and such instead of plain sit-down meals?
I don't know.
My poor old Willie, you never know much and understand less. But what are them two doing in that old laboratory?
Oh, something mighty important.
Something with that man you drug in like he was another animal for the doc to mess around with?
Now, Lucy, you hush up. The doc, he knows better than the whole world what he's doing. Ain't nobody else like him.
But I ain't all so sure as you. It's all good.
You happen to talk like that way. He's the nearest thing to a preacher and more close to God than anyone I ever knew.
Well, most times I get the feeling that what he's doing is flying in the face of God.
That's it, Miguel. That is it. Oh, you are a good patient.
Werner.
Yes, it is. Huh?
Must we watch over it day and night?
Oh, not it, Liebchen. Him. Miguel is alive and well. As long as the brain lives, the man lives.
For what reason? It is only an island of cells, floating in a protective bath like the placenta in a womb. But it cannot grow. It cannot communicate. It is only a medical trick.
Oh, not this time, Ilse, not this time. It cannot grow, perhaps, but it can remember. And if you give me time, it will communicate. With $2 million at stake, trust me, I will find a way to make it communicate, to make Miguel release his secret.
Dr. Werner Dietart, a madman or a genius? Can he really keep alive a mass of gray cells divorced from the human body, fed by machines which simulate the function of the heart? And even if he can accomplish that miracle, how can he communicate with this pulsing pearl gray organ which floats like some tropical jellyfish in its nourishing private sea? I'll return shortly with Act Two. Miguel Rivera's brain is all that is left of the man who once bore that name. The recognizable part of him, the body, is long since reduced to white ash in Dr. Dietart's private ovens, an ash now scattered to the four winds. But in another world, the more recognizable everyday one you and I inhabit, a vast network of law enforcement officials is painstakingly trying to locate Miguel and the $2 million he escaped with when he parachuted out of the plane.
Governor, we got every foot of territory he could possibly have landed on or moved to since covered. But like I say, Governor, that's wild country. And a man could hole up snug as a prairie dog or be long gone into Mexico by now, particularly since he was Spanish-speaking. Oh, no, sir, don't you worry. We're staying right on top of it.
Sheriff, you got anything new?
No, Bill. Not since identification. Miguel Rivera, ex-paratrooper, U.S. Army, Vietnam veteran. No previous arrests or convictions. Just a plain guy who blew his stack and made a grab for the brass ring.
So you don't mind if I hang around? I mean, this is a big news break for me and my station.
We need all the help we can get. And you news broadcasters are not to leave.
So you figure he had Confederates waiting for him after the jump?
No. No, just strictly on my own hunch, I figure him for a loner.
See, there's another thing, Sheriff, that the co-pilot mentioned.
What's that?
Well, with that submachine gun and that suitcase loaded, he was carrying a pretty heavy load for jumping.
You suggesting there was any chance he might have hurt himself landing?
Well, I don't
with
know.
With two parachutes and him a paratrooper?
Like I say, it was just a thought.
Well, don't think it ain't occurred to me. That's why our helicopter's been flying so low. That reminds me. I gotta put another call into that foreign doctor fella up Dreadville way. Just like to check him. Though it don't make no sense for Rivera's backtracking that way. Well, just in case he's seen or heard anything.
Well, my best guess is that he had some horses staked out. Or maybe even a jeep, so he could get away across the border.
Well, by this time, my guess is he's sheer out of this world far as we're concerned.
I really wish I could help you out, Sheriff. Riveras, you said his name was?
That's right.
And he stole $2 million?
Doctor, don't you listen to the radio or the TV?
Oh, yes, of course. I have heard the story, but it is so unbelievable.
Well, no matter the way it sounds, you can believe it. If he escapes, he's got $2 million clear profit because there's no way those bills can be traced.
It is really incredible. Tell me, do you have any hope of finding him?
Well, he can't just have vanished into thin air.
Werner, what did the police say?
They can't trace Miguel. But the money...
They found it?
No, not yet. It means we have little time. We can't search for it with the police everywhere. We must find out from Miguel where he hid it.
Miguel?
His brain is still alive. It is only left for me to find a way to discover what his brain knows.
Willie?
Yes, Lucy?
Where are you going?
I gotta... go help the doctor and Mrs. Doctor.
Now? This time of night? Help them do what?
I don't know. Magic kind of things.
Tell me, what are they doing in that laboratory or whatever you call it?
I don't know. But the doctor needs me. I gotta go.
Oh, Willie, I'm scared. You know what I think?
No. Why, Lucy?
I think you and me ought to cut and run while the going's good.
Now, don't lay any trouble on me, woman. I can't leave. The doctor, he needs me. And Mrs. Doctor.
And what about me?
Well, the doctor and the Mrs. Doctor is my job. They need me first.
Oh, Willie, boy. Honey, don't you know they'd be the first to shuck you off the moment they didn't need you, and I'd be the last?
You hadn't ought to think anything mean about them, Lucy. Willie just knows his place is all. You gotta know it, too.
Willie, I just know only one thing. You're my man, and I love you. And I won't ever let anybody harm you.
Now, you understand what we must do, Ilsa. The first thing is to make the brain hear.
But why? We have the electronic larynx, which we've used with sheep and dogs. All Miguel's brain must do is speak.
Well, how can it answer? How can Miguel answer if he does not hear the words?
The animals answered.
Because we induced a small measure of pain. Then they would react vocally with a bleat or with a squeak, a bark. Then it was a simplistic process, a reflex action. Now we must establish a very complex one. So, you take this microphone, and when I tell you, you will speak.
Oh, and what is the box you have on the table?
This is an interfacing device which will multiply the signal into speech patterns.
Shall I try it now?
No. First, we make adjustments. You can watch on the oscilloscope and see the voice grams as we hear them. All right, now. Speak softly. Say the name. Miguel. Miguel. Slowly over and over again while I adjust the sensitivity.
But how do you transmit it to the brain?
The same way as we do with the larynx for the return operation. Now, I must implant these electrodes in the auditory cortex. So, Ilsa, you speak, but softly, softly.
Miguel. Miguel. Miguel.
So, I have them planted.
Well, how can we tell if Miguel can hear? There is no reaction.
Of course not. The brain has no muscle. It can only reply to one electrical impulse by a responding one.
And you'll attach the electrical larynx now.
Yes. Since we know that Broca's area is specifically the seat of articulate speech. There, and I have had practice with animals, I can be more sure of this operation. The other is hit or miss. It may take time and patience to set those electrodes accurately. Now, let me have the microphone, please.
Yes, here, Werner.
Miguel. Miguel? Can you hear me?
Nothing. Does not work.
I must adjust the auditory circuit. It is very delicate. It may take a long time. A very long time.
Hi, Sheriff. You got anything new on Rivera's?
Not a glimmer.
What do you suppose he did with the parachute?
Buried him, I reckon. Well, by now, we got men on foot going over every inch of that territory. You ought to pick up some trail.
The only trouble was that rainstorm.
Yeah, probably washed out any sign of that skyjacker. I can't sit here any longer at a desk. I'm getting out in the field. The man can't just have disappeared into thin air.
Miguel.
Hey, what's going on in there, Willie?
Miguel, can you hear me?
Doctor's trying to talk to that man we found. Side of the road.
But the man died, Willie. You and me burned him in the oven and scattered his ashes.
And not all of them.
What do you mean?
He kept out one part of them.
What part?
His brain. Prettiest thing. All shiny and white gray like.
Willie.
What?
You... You trying to tell me that brain in behind that door is alive?
That's what it is. He's been keeping it alive, too, with that old two-cycle pump I helped him build.
But if the brain is alive, that means the man was alive when he took it from him.
I reckon. What's the difference?
Well, I'll tell you what's the difference. That means that man was murdered. And if the police ever find out, we could stand to be put in jail for burning up and hiding what was left of him.
Miguel, can you hear me, Miguel?
It's no good, Werner. It won't work.
Now, patience, Ilsa, patience. We just try a new placement of all the electrodes. Now, Miguel.
Yes. I hear
you. Werner.
Here, take the microphone, Ilsa. Speak to him while I modulate. I must get it into exact phase.
Now?
Yes, now.
Miguel.
Keep on, yes. Don't stop.
Miguel. Yes. Miguel, can you hear me? Can you hear me, Miguel?
Ask him again, Ilsa. I've almost got the setting.
Miguel, I'm talking to you. If you hear, reply.
Yes. Yes, I hear.
Give me the microphone. Miguel, you understand me?
Where am I? Who are you? What happened to me?
Now, Miguel, we must take this very easy, step by step. First, I am a doctor.
A doctor? What is this place? A hospital?
My private hospital, yes.
But where am I?
I told you, in my hospital.
I don't mean that. I mean, where am I? Me, Miguel Rivers. Where is my body? I can't see. What happened to me?
Now, Miguel, you must not be excited. What happened to you it will take quite a bit of explaining.
Quite a bit of explaining, I should think. What does one say exactly to a man who is no longer a man, but only a brain, which is being kept functioning by sheerly artificial means? And for that, I'm afraid we shall have to wait until I return shortly with Act 3. It has been a long, careful, and repetitive task for Dr. Werner Dietart to explain the circumstances which have brought Miguel Riveras back to life. If we may give a name to a brain without a body. So far, Miguel has contributed little to the conversation. Or, should we say, the last vestige of Miguel that is still extant. It is hard even to estimate just how much he has comprehended. Until, for the first time, he speaks at length.
Padre nostro, que está en los cielos, santificado sea tu nombre, venganos.
What is he saying?
He is praying.
What is to become of him?
He can die if he wants. After.
After what?
After I get the money, huh? Miguel.
What is it?
Do you feel... I mean, are you ready to tell us your story?
Why did you do this to me?
I had no choice. You were so severely damaged internally. Death was inevitable. The brain was all I could rescue.
Why didn't you just let me die?
In these modern times, it is a doctor's duty to do everything he can to maintain life.
Did you call the police?
Well, actually, no.
Why not?
Because they could not help you, and you could help me in a way that they would not have allowed.
By becoming one of your guinea pigs.
A most valuable one. A real guinea pig in the sense that the guinea is a golden coin.
What are you after, man?
When you jumped from that plane, you had with you $2 million, no?
But yes, in small bills, not over 20.
But when Willie and I found you, there was no money.
Who is Willie?
My hired man, a general handyman. A little slow in the brain, but a magnificent physical specimen and very useful to me.
Okay, I didn't ask for his life history.
I don't intend to give it to you. I am much too interested in that money. Now, where is it, Miguel?
No. No money.
What?
I mean, no deal. Where it is, that is my secret.
But I think you will tell me. I am sure you will.
What makes you so sure?
Oh, my dear Miguel, if we cannot agree, I have only to, how shall we say, pull the plug and you cease to be.
Werner, you couldn't.
Oh, you won't get it out of me by threats, Doc. By me, you might as well pull the plug. What have I got to live for anyway?
Miguel, we can share.
What for? What could a human jellyfish floating in a bath of salt water use it for? Well, wait a minute. I just thought of something. How about a deal?
A deal?
Yeah. If you are so clever that you could take my brain out of my body and keep it living, why can't you put it back in some other body? I mean, like one that is okay and keep both alive.
You mean create a real Frankenstein monster?
No monster, just a guy like I was.
Very well. Very well. It was merely a figure of speech, so to say, but where am I going to... Ah, yes, of course.
Werner, please, what are you thinking?
Willie, why not? As a person, he is only half complete anyway. His brain is retarded. Arch, I would be doing both of them a favor.
Werner, you must be mad.
Don't say that word to me. And if I could accomplish this miracle, Miguel, what would your deal be?
Oh, anything you want, Doc. You just give me enough money to get across the border and get lost. And you can have anything you want.
Very well. Where is the money?
Oh, no, no. First, you make your monster, Doctor. Then comes the money.
But how can I trust you?
Me? The cards are all stacked against me. When I come out of this operation, I will be weak as a kitten. Only then I will want to live. You think I won't come clean then?
And supposing you do not come through?
I might as well be dead anyways. That is the chance you've got to take.
No. No, not good enough. I give you a better, what you say, deal. I will prepare Willie for the operation. You will be beside the table. And at the moment I prepare him to receive your brain, then you tell me where the money is.
Okay, Doc. You win. Then I will take on.
I beg you, please, Werner, don't do this.
Ilta, do not be a fool. I must. We are out of money. This is a godsend.
It is not a license for you to try to play God. This operation is impossible, even if we had the facilities and the resources, which we don't.
You are even more of a fool than I thought you. You don't suppose I'm going to attempt the operation? I know it can't be done. The important thing is to convince Miguel, that captive brain, that it can.
But it... He will not tell you till you have taken away Willie's brain.
So?
But that will kill him.
Willie is nothing. He is dispensable.
But that's murder.
In the name of science, Ilse. And to save our own necks.
Doctor, I'm just not going to let you do it. I'm just not going to.
My dear woman, you should be thanking me. I'm going to make that man of yours a whole man.
Well, even if it would work, I wouldn't thank you for that.
Why?
Oh, look at me, Doctor. I ain't much. No education. And at the most, you couldn't call me nothing but just a plain woman. I look in the glass, I know I'm a downright ugly one. But with Willie as he is, it's good enough. I can make him happy.
This is beginning to irritate me, Lucy.
Look, if there's no other way, I'll go to the police.
Do you think for a moment I would... Lucy, where did you get that gun?
It's Willie's, but I know how to use it if I have to.
No, isn't this silly, Lucy? You know my regard for Willie. Would I do anything to harm him in any way?
No, don't move! Oh, no!
Poor, foolish, ugly little woman. I did not mean your death. But I have practiced survival too long to let anything stop me now. Is Willie anesthetized?
Yes. What kept you?
I was just scrubbing up.
I couldn't leave Willie, but I thought I heard...
What?
Like, far away, a gunshot.
A gunshot? Who has a gun? Oh, yes, some supplies came from town. Lucy is attending to them, and that old truck of Seth's backfired when he was leaving. Now, so, are we ready?
The patient is, but I am not.
Oh, Ilse, trust me. We have been through so much together, and this is our last chance.
What can I do? You're all I have left. Not even myself.
So, we commence... Scalpel.
Yes. Oh, yes, madam. Now, if you could just wait a minute and let me double check.
I don't care. I told you I don't care. Hurry. Help.
No. Don't hang up. Just let me get this straight. I... Oh. Hey, hello? Hello? Can you hear me? Hello.
What you got, Bill?
Oh, Chef, I hope to tell you the craziest darn part of nonsense you ever heard.
About what?
The Rivera's case.
Well, anything you picked up on that, I want to hear. I don't give a hoot how plain damn foolish it is.
So, we make the cut.
No respiration.
Of course. Willie's body is now moribund.
Werner, this is wrong. So wrong.
It is all that is right for me anymore. So, Miguel, here is the moment of truth.
You mean my new body is ready?
Ready and waiting. The brain already removed. We have only seconds. The money.
See. The purely mesa of the loving sisters.
Yes.
Below over there is a canyon with the river of Los Muertes.
Yes.
Rising to the mesa, there are three buttes. The one to the south, there, at the base, by the river, there is a cave where the trail ends. In that is the money. So, I have lived up to my part of the deed. Now you...
Oh, Miguel, trust me.
Where are you going, Werner?
I have turned off his hearing to check out the money. You keep him alive till I come back.
And Willie?
Willie was feeble-minded enough to risk his neck. Too bad it was chopped off.
Doctor, Mrs. Dickhart, somebody.
Yes, Miguel. What?
Is the operation over?
Miguel, how can I tell you? There was no operation. Willie is dead. The doctor has only been cheating you.
And where is he now?
I'm beginning to realize. Cheating me, too. He's long gone. With all the money.
Oh, no. There is no money.
What do you mean?
Oh, you see, I thought I was got two perfect eyes, two parachutes to cover all the extra weight of my guns and the money. But one of them failed. I was coming down too fast. I had lost control of the landing I was heading for. I had overshot the desert, and I was in among the hills to try to save my life. At the last moment, 1,000 feet up. I let go the bag with the money. And somehow it opened and the beers went raining down like snowflakes into the narrow gorge, into the river. To be swept away God knows where. Oh, no. There is no money. Just as there is no Miguel.
Then why has my husband not come back?
Because I hope the police found him there. If they had found my parachute, they would have been waiting. Caramba, is it not wonderful? They could never have gotten him for my murder. But they will for poor Willie, or whatever his name is.
And his poor wife. I will go and let them in.
Bill, tell the boys to bring in the doctor. Okay, Mrs. Deedhart. Where's the other corpse?
Oh, in the laboratory there.
Yeah, there's the handyman. On the table.
Oh. Lord, what kind of butch?
Oh, Bill, turn that damn radio off, will you? Just pull the plug. Place gives me the creeps.
Oh, look at this, Bill.
What is it, Sheriff?
What must be? Must be the brain the poor murdered woman was babbling about on the phone.
That thing is a brain?
I reckon.
Don't look much alive by now.
It won't be. Not since you pulled out the plug.
Well, what do you mean?
When you pulled the plug, you stopped all the supportive measures which kept it alive.
You mean I killed it?
Exactly. Oh, come, young man. Don't look so distressed. You have me safely guilty of two deliberate and merciless murders. How lucky you are. You committed a sheerly accidental and merciful one.
Dr. Werner Deedhart and his wife were tried and convicted for the murders of Lucy and Willie Holland. She was sentenced to life imprisonment, he to the death penalty. I shall be back shortly. In the beginning, I promised you an unforgettable voyage to the islands of Kalea. Did you think I'd forgotten? Oh, no. You have just made that voyage. For this cluster of small islands exist only in the cortex of the brain. Our cast included Norman Rose, Bryna Rayburn, Leon Janney, and Ian Martin. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. And now, a preview of our next tale.
The effect only lasts for an hour or so, but we can't be sure of it until we try it on a human. On the rats in the lab, it lasted 1 hour. Then, gradually, they reappeared. No worse for the experience.
Then it's not dangerous?
Not to the animals, but we've got to try it on a human to really find out. To get the subjective reactions. I mean, will I see myself? Or will I look down and see nothing but space? How will I move? My body will still be there. I won't be able to walk through things like a ghost, or will I? These are the questions we have to answer with a human subject.
You.
Me.
You'll come out of it all right.
We hope and expect so. The effect has to wear off.
And if it doesn't?
You'll never see me again.
Radio Mystery Theater was sponsored in part by Contact, the 12-hour cold capsule. This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.